shout of praise this morning. Come on. It was alive that morning on that Easter morning. He's alive this morning. Amen. Come on, let's just give the Lord a shout of praise in here. Hallelujah. I know he's an awesome God this morning. And we serve a risen Savior today. Amen. A good God. Amen. Right now, would you just raise your hands towards heaven and ask the blessings of the Lord upon this service this morning. And ask God to speak to hearts and lives and those that are lost. And God would save this morning by his mighty hand and power. Come on, would you just reach out to him this morning and let him touch you in a mighty, mighty way this morning. Father, we thank you. God, we come before that throne this morning. God, touch every heart that's in this building. God, minister to every need. God, when we leave here, we'll say, for surely the Lord is in this place. Thank you for the goodness that you've been to us, Lord. Thank you for that loving kindness this morning. Father, we're going to praise you. We're going to thank you for it. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Come on, just worship him. Enter into worship this morning. And let the Spirit of God just bless you this morning, would you? that he lives this morning. Amen. Come on, let's give the Lord a shout of praise in the house. Come on, let's make it sound like church this morning. Hallelujah. He's a mighty good God. You can be seated this morning. God bless you. Amen. How many knows he's an awesome good God this morning? Amen. We're celebrating this day as, amen, our Savior rising from the dead. Amen. We know that he's a resurrected Savior because he lives in us this morning. How many of y'all glad to be alive here this morning? Amen. Come on, let's just give the Lord a shout of praise one more time. Amen. He's a good God. Mighty good God this morning. Amen. Appreciate the goodness of the Lord. Without music, amen. Let's put that back up there. Let's just sing a chorus of that again, would you? And because he lives, I can face tomorrow. That's how I face tomorrow, church. Come on.
Because he lives.
Lift your voices to him.
All fear is gone. And because I know.
Yes, I do. Yes, I do.
He holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives.
See, there's no life outside that this morning. And because he lives, this altar's open. If you're lost this morning, if you don't know Jesus Christ, this altar's open right now. You can know Jesus as your Savior. Hallelujah. Leave this workplace changed this morning.
All fear is gone. And because I know.
Hallelujah. Yes.
He holds my future. And life is worth the living just because.
Amen. Woo, hallelujah. I hear people say they may be mad enough to make my blood boil. That makes my blood want to boil right there because he lives this morning. Amen. Alive in the Lord this morning. Amen. Would you give the Lord another shout of praise this morning? Amen. Hallelujah. Again, we are grateful. Thank you for being with us this morning at Solid Rock Church. We're going to have a great time in the Lord. Amen. The church alive is still worth the drive. How many believes that? Amen. He's a good God. Amen. Good God this morning. Amen. Amen. Brother Jason, this morning is going to come and get ready to receive our tithes and our offerings. And we thank you for your faithfulness and your giving this morning. Give Brother Jason a good hand as he comes and receives our tithes and offerings this morning.
Give everybody an opportunity to get blessed this morning. Amen. So good to be in the house of the Lord. And amen. You know it was him that gave you the power to get here this morning. Amen. It was because his will and his grace, amen, that you woke up this morning. Amen. So I know it's Easter season. And man, I tell you what, the Bible says it's more blessed to give than to receive. And man, guys, we do plenty of receiving. Amen. We are so blessed. I mean, you can go through a sickness and be blessed. Amen. You can go through a financial crisis and still be blessed because the Word of God said you would be as a tree planted beside the waters. Amen. I want to read this, just a couple of scriptures this morning just to encourage you and give. And thank you for being faithful. And those that are givers and faithful and you have a heart to give, God's promises to you says that he would open the windows of heaven. Amen. He would pour you out a blessing. I don't care what Satan tells you, but that's the promise of God. And if you can do that this morning and believe in your giving, when you give, don't just give because it's everybody else is giving. But if you'll sow, actually sow,
yes.
Amen, sow. And when you sow something, you're taking pride in what you're doing. You're expecting results. When a farmer sows, he expects results. So as you give this morning, if you will expect some results, sowing in faith, God will open the windows of heaven for you. Romans 8, just real quickly here, it says 31, what shall we say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? And this is the season, and this is just great giving scripture. He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not amen, also freely give us all things, amen. It goes on to say, who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifieth, amen. He that spared not only his only son, how shall he not surely, amen, surely get you through this hardship? Surely bless what you're going to give this morning. Amen. Thank you for being faithful, Solid Rock, in your tithing. Amen. Thank you for that. Amen. He said he would rebuke the devourer for your sakes. Amen. If the offering takers are come, we'll get ready to receive the offering. Just good to have our visitors this morning and all the faithful church folk as well. Reach your hands this way and let's ask the Lord's blessings. Father, we just thank you this morning. Lord, we thank you for always meeting the needs. Father, we thank you for blessing and multiplying. So many times when we had very little, God, you always made a way. And we know you'll continue to do that, Lord. We give in faith this morning, Father. We thank you. We sow into the kingdom of God, knowing, Lord, that you'll meet the needs. Knowing, Lord, hallelujah, that you'll make a way. We ask you to bless this. Bless this offering in Jesus' name. Amen.
Powerful name it is, and nothing can stand against. Jesus, you brought heaven down. Oh, but you see, my sins were great, but your love was greater. Yes, it was. Oh, I could separate us now. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is.
And that all over this congregation, would you stand to your feet one more time? And let's give God a praise. He just saved this young lady. Just saved this young lady. What a wonderful name. Hallelujah. Would somebody give him a praise? Just saved her soul this morning by the power of God. Hallelujah. This altar's over. If anybody else wants to be saved this morning.
What a powerful name it is. Ain't nothing can stand again.
What a powerful name it is, the name.
Everybody raise your hand and sing it unto him tonight. His powerful name this morning.
What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is, and nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name
we'll sing
of
again one more time.
Jesus. And what a powerful name it is, what a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it
oh,
is,
yes.
And nothing can stand again.
Hallelujah.
What a powerful name it is, the name
we'll
of
sing it again.
Jesus.
What a powerful name.
What a powerful name it
oh, yes.
is,
Hallelujah.
The name of Jesus
Hallelujah.
Christ my King. What a powerful name it is,
and
nothing can stand again. What a powerful name it is, the name of
oh, get that in your spirit.
Jesus. What a powerful name it is, what a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. Christ my King.
Oh yes.
What a powerful name it is, and nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
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 Thank you, Lord. You know, they go to rock and roll concerts, country concerts, all kind of ball games, and they hoop and they holler and they shout. I believe things should be done decent in order, but if we don't lift our voices and praise Him, the Bible said the rocks can cry out. And I believe this morning we ought to thank God that He's alive this morning and give Him worship and praise. Amen. Church shouldn't be dead. Church should be the leader in being alive this morning. Amen. By the grace of God. When Mary came from that tomb, she hollered, "He's alive! He's alive! He's still alive today!" Amen. By the grace of God. Amen. You may be seated this morning. God bless you. But I tell you what, amen, that young lady that prayed, amen, power of God was on her. Amen. I want you to give the Lord a great big shout of praise for that. Do you rather have that than anything else in this world? Amen. Hallelujah. He's a mighty good God this morning. Amen. God's a good God. How many knows He's a good God? God bless you, sis. Amen. Hallelujah. You got to change life. Make all the difference in the world. Amen. Heaven knows He's a good God this morning. Amen. Appreciate the goodness of the Lord this morning. Amen. Got one more song we want to sing before we change the service this morning. Amen. I'm so privileged and blessed this morning to have my wife and my children and my grandson in the house of the Lord this morning. I also have my brother with me this morning and his wife. Amen. And I've got my mom and my dad this morning. They're still alive, and I'm very fortunate, amen, to have both of them this morning. Amen. And I appreciate them this morning. And I want my dad's going to sing a song this morning. And a few months ago, he couldn't even get up by himself. He couldn't walk, talk, or do anything hardly. And God just blessed him mightily. So, Dad, come on, would you, this morning? Amen. Would you give him and the Lord a good hand? We have not practiced this a long time, but we're going to. Come on, Dad. Give it to Dad. Real soft. This song is entitled "The Three Old Rusty Nails." Many years ago, Jimmy Davis made this song famous, which was the governor of Louisiana. And it's called "The Three Rusty Nails," the three nails. And listen to this song. It's a recitation on this. Just listen to it and let the Lord bless your heart this morning.
As I recall, located in Jerusalem across the street from Pilate's Hall. I thought I had everything that anyone would need, and folks would come from miles around me, regardless of the creed. The only thing I didn't think that I could ever sell was in a corner on the shelf, three old rusty spike nails. Then one day a big Roman soldier came through the doors. As he walked up to me, it seemed he almost shook the floor. I said, "Can I help you, sir?" With a voice I guess seemed frail. He just looked at me and grinned, said, "I want to buy some big, big nails. Three old rusty spikes is all I have." He said to me, "That'll do. For the job I have, three's enough. How much I owe you?" He put the money in my hand, and I was glad to make the sale. Then I wondered and I asked him, "Sir, what can you do with just three nails?" He said, "Do you ever hear of a man called Jesus the Nazarene? You mean the one who goes about doing good?" He said, "Yes, that's the man. Well, today I intend to show the world that I'm boss. These three old rusty spikes, I'm going to nail Jesus to the cross." I stood there almost numb. You'll never know how I felt. I said, "Please, sir, don't do that." As on my knees I knelt, but he just turned and walked away, and I got up and followed him. I said, "Please, sir, I will buy them back," but he just looked at me and grinned. But at a distance I could see the howling mob through the tears that fell my eyes. "Away with him, crucify him." Oh, I could hear the angry cries. And over top of all the noise and the gums of anger, I could hear the sound of the hammer as that big Roman soldier nailed Jesus to the tree.
Glad of that this morning, amen. Give the Lord a praise on that. Amen. Hallelujah. Give my dad a great big hand this morning, would you? He remembers that recitation by memory, being 84 years old. He's done good. Hallelujah. Amen. He's a mighty good God this morning. Amen. Amen. I believe that we have one more thing before we change this. How many's glad to that song this morning? Ain't that an awesome song? Amen. Hallelujah. He's a mighty good God. Amen. Appreciate God's goodness and his mercies this morning. Amen. Amen. All right, you can go to your Sunday school this morning and just, amen, let the Lord bless you and amen. Oh, Autumn's birthday, yes. Where's Autumn at? Autumn, come here. It's your birthday today. Where's Brother Buddy at?
A couple days, a couple months before his death.
Still counting the money? Okay. I'll get him at once. Let's sing happy birthday to Autumn right quick, okay? Happy birthday to you, a happy birthday to you. May you happy birthday. Hallelujah. Give her the Lord a good hand this morning. Mighty good God, and we're so glad that you're with us this morning. And if you're here for your first time, we thank God for you and appreciate you being with us. Amen. I want you to feel at home in the house of the Lord this morning. Amen. He's an awesome God. Amen. And I do believe in worshiping the Lord. I believe in praising him. Amen. I don't believe in being a spectacle, but I love the Lord. Somebody shout amen this morning. Amen. As I said, we are celebrating this time of the year. Amen, as the resurrection of our Lord and Savior. And I was preparing and I was praying about what to really to preach on this morning, being traditional, being Easter Sunday or something maybe a little differently. And the Lord began to deal with me and speak to my heart on this. And it has to do with the crucifixion and the resurrection. Who knows that God is a good God this morning? Amen. An awesome God. You that have your Bibles, if you'll go with me this morning to the book of Matthew chapter 27, the 27th chapter of the book of Matthew this morning. And this is talking about the trial of Jesus. It was a mockery. It was not done correctly. Excuse me. It was not done correctly. And they was trying to get rid of Jesus. And they were trying to do away. And how many knows the day that people are still trying to do away with the Lord Jesus? Amen. But he's still God. And no matter what you do, he's to be God today, tomorrow, no matter what. How many believes that this morning? Amen. And I appreciate the goodness of God. And I'm glad that I have put my faith in something I know is real this morning. Amen. They sang that old song, if God's dead, who is this living on the inside of me? Amen. I know he's alive this morning. Amen. I know he's alive when I seen, amen, that young lady come down the front this morning and give her heart to the Lord, friend. God's still saving. How many knows God's still healing? God's still delivering? God's still moving? He's still God. Amen. Somebody shout, he's still God this morning. Amen. He's still God. And, you know, this is a universal question this morning. And it don't just happen today or around Easter time. This is a really a decision, amen, that every one of us have to make from time to time, because there'll come a time in your life that Satan will put pressure on you to deny what you really believe. Amen. It will. Amen. Or just hush and don't say anything about what you believe. Amen. But God's a mighty good God. Somebody shout amen. He's a good God this morning. So in the book of Matthew chapter 27, let's go back to about verse number 22. Let's back up to about verse 15, okay? Let's back up to verse 15 this morning of Matthew there, 27. Amen. God's a good God. Pilate, they had brought him to the chief priest, and amen, that Judas had betrayed him, and all this had happened, and Jesus was in the trial, and Pilate had something to do with this. The Bible says, now at the feast of the governor was wont to release unto the multitude one prisoner. It was a custom that they would release someone, amen, no matter what they had done, no matter how guilty they was, no matter what they had, if they was a murderer, which Barabbas was a murderer, he was a thief, amen. But it was still the custom to release someone at that Passover, amen. And this is what it's talking about right here. And the governor will want to release unto the multitude one prisoner whom they would. They had a choice whom they would release. And they had then a notable prisoner called Barabbas. Now, if we could put it in our day, we could use a notable prisoner, someone that, amen, has done a lot of crime, amen, someone that deserves to die. But, amen, amen, listen to what this multitude said. Barabbas should have died here, but Jesus still took his place. Somebody say amen to that one. Wherefore, when they were gathered together, this was the crowd, Pilate said unto them, whom will ye that I release unto you, Barabbas or Jesus, which is called the Christ? For he knew that for envy they had delivered him, which was Jesus. And when he was set down on the judgment seat, his wife said unto him, saying, have thou nothing to do with this just man, for I have suffered many things this day in a dream because of him. This was Jesus now. But the chief priests and the elders persuaded the multitude that they should ask for Barabbas and destroy Jesus. The governor answered and said unto them, whether of the twain will ye that I release unto you? And they said, Barabbas. Pilate said unto them, here is the question today that every one of us have to answer. What shall I do then with Jesus, which is called the Christ? And they, the multitude, said unto him, let him be crucified. And the governor said, why? What evil has he done? But they cried out the more, saying, let him be crucified. Somebody shout amen. Amen. And when Pilate saw that he could prevail nothing, but that rather a tumult or a riot would be made, he took water and washed his hands. Now watch this. Amen. Pilate thought because he could play the neutral game, I guess you could say, that he could just wash his hands and say, I've got nothing to do with this. But Pilate did not stand up for him. Amen. Amen. And wash his hands before the multitude, saying, I am innocent of the blood of this just person. See ye to it. Thank you. Now, when you look at this morning, amen, you've got to choose whether to serve him or to deny him. How many believes that? You've got a choice that you have to make. I can't make it for you. You can't make it for me. You've got to decide what you're going to do with Jesus. Are you going to live for him and serve him and let him be the Lord of your life, or will you deny him? Somebody said, I've talked to sinners before that said, I wouldn't deny the Lord. I said, if you don't serve him, you are denying what he done for you. Now, that may be strong, but it's still the truth this morning. Either you love him or you hate him. Amen. That's the word of God. Can I get a witness in this house? Amen. And I want to begin to think about this morning. Jesus is more than a symbol of celebration. He is the Son of God. He's the creator of everything. How many believes that this morning? He's still God. Hallelujah. How many glad that you've got that kind of victory this morning that you know who he is? Amen. Would you give the Lord one more shout of praise in this house? I want you to give God some praise because he is worthy today. Amen. Amen. When somebody wins a championship, everybody wants to praise. But Jesus won the grand eternal championship. Amen. Over death this morning by the grace of God. Amen. Hallelujah. How many knows he's a mighty good God this morning? Amen. Daniel, if you'll back up in your scriptures, amen, to verse number 22 again. And I want to ask you that question again. What will you do with Jesus? Amen. What are you going to do with him in your life? Now, I see people sometimes they get saved and, amen, they join the church and they think that's all it is to it. And they sort of put the Lord on a shelf and they go on and live their life, amen, the way they want to. But, amen, you got to make him the Lord of your life. Somebody said it's born being a Christian. I said there ain't nothing born about being a child of God. Amen. There's joy in the Lord this morning. There's victory in God this morning. Amen. There's a little shouting in the Lord sometimes. Amen. He's a mighty good God. What are you going to do with the Lord when troubles come? What are you going to do with the Lord, amen, when that decision, amen, you know, I heard some people tell me one time, they said, if you don't have a very spiritual church, you bring more people because people don't like to be disturbed. Well, I said, I'm going to tell you something. If you die and go to hell, you're going to be disturbed a whole lot. And blood will be required in somebody's hands for not telling somebody the truth. Somebody shout amen. You know any ball team, you know any kind of athletic competition, if you don't do your best, you're not going to win. Amen. With being a child of God, if you don't give it your best, you're not going to mount to much in the things of the Lord. And God says, amen, I declare of you, I want your whole heart. I want you to love me with everything that you got, your heart, your soul, your mind, your body, and your strength. I want to know what you're going to do with the Lord today. Amen. And ever what you decide to do with him, you're going to be held accountable at Judgment Day for that. How many people, I wonder how many people sitting here this morning, I know that some are, amen, that, amen, came to church and gave your heart to God over the past years because your life was in shambles. Your home was falling apart. Nerve pills wasn't even helping you that much. Amen. Amen. Nothing was helping you because, amen, your life was without God. See, everything is a substitute if you don't have God in your life. Amen. No matter what happens, no matter what you're putting your hope and faith in this morning, it's a substitute if you don't have God this morning. And somewhere, it's going to let you down. Can I get a witness in this house? So when I look at these scriptures this morning, it says, what shall I do with Jesus? Amen. Now, I want you to go to another scripture this morning. Amen. Go to, 1 Corinthians, amen, chapter 2 and verse number 8. Amen. I quoted this scripture earlier today. Amen. And I want you to understand, if the princes of this world had known who Jesus was, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. Can I get a witness in this house? Amen. God, I want you to understand something this morning. You've got to know who he is this morning. And if you don't know who he is, you're going to be in a lot of trouble. Amen. God's a mighty good God. Amen. The Bible says there in verse number 8, which none of the rulers of this world had known. For if they had known it, if they had known who Jesus was, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But, amen, if you'll go on over now, amen, to 2 Corinthians chapter number 4 and verse number 4, it's going to tell us why that they didn't know the Lord of glory. How many of y'all saved here this morning? And I've heard people say this, why didn't I get saved earlier after they got saved? Why did I fight this? Why did I turn from this? Why did I wait all my life before I got saved? Amen. Here's the reason why. In whom the God of this world has blinded the mind of them which believe not. See, amen. Satan has a way of blinding people's minds and causing them to delay or procrastinate or put off. I'll get saved next week. I'll serve God out yonder. I'm going to serve God when I get out of college. I'm going to serve God when I get everything really in line and in order. I'm going to start serving God when I get ready to retire. Amen. You ain't got a promise of tomorrow this morning. You ain't got a promise that you'll see tomorrow. Amen. We ain't got a promise of leaving out of here today. Can I get a witness in this house this morning? Amen. So today is the day of salvation. Amen. And when those excuses begin to come, well, I'll serve God next week, or I'll serve God when my boyfriend does, or I'll serve God when my girlfriend does, or when my wife gets saved. But the Bible talks individually to you. It's your choice today what you do. What are you going to do with Jesus? Now look at this. What are you going to do with him? Pilate said, well, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm not going to serve him, but I'm just not going to have anything to do with the crucifixion. But Pilate couldn't get away from it. He had to make a stand. And if you don't take a stand for the Lord, you take a stand against the Lord. Anybody with me on this morning? Amen. And we're in an hour that is too much flimsy and flopsy and, amen, and wishy-washy in and out. But it's time to make up your mind. I'm going to serve the Lord. I'm going to love the Lord. Amen. Death can't separate me. Life can't separate me. Angels can't separate me. Nothing can separate me from the love of God this morning. Amen. You're going to have that kind of determination if you want a life in Christ. Amen. I hear people sometimes say it's hard to serve the Lord. It's hard to serve the Lord half-heartedly. Amen. I'll tell y'all a little story. I don't like telling you stories, but I'm going to tell you because Barry's good. Since Gene and I, when we first started dating, I just got to know her. And y'all know I never met a family like them. I mean, there's a family. They'd stand up for each other, but they'd fight. Wham. They had temper. They had temper without a fuse. Somebody shout amen. Just shake the bottle a little bit. I see some more out there looks like that this morning. And this is years ago. We're talking about 46, 47 years ago. And I don't know. She didn't come to church one night or something, and my dad was pastoring, and amen, she didn't come to church, and I don't know. Somebody walked up and said something to me, some other girl or something. I don't even know why he's even about. Amen. But one of her friends saw me say something to her, and she went and told Gene that I was talking to another girl. Shook the bottle. And she come to me later, and she said, I'm going to tell you something. She said, I don't care how many girlfriends you have. I didn't know what she was talking about. She said, I don't care how many girlfriends you have. But if you got them, you don't have me. Now, if you got me, you don't have no more. That was plain English, and I could understand that real well. Come on, somebody. Huh? And that's the same way with the Lord. Either you love him with everything, you can't love him with one hand and the world. You got to make your mind up. I'm going to follow Jesus. I'm going to serve him with everything I got. Amen. Now, some of y'all sitting there acting real innocent like that didn't happen to you, but I guarantee you probably did. Somebody shout amen. But God's a good God this morning. Amen. So here's the thing about it. Amen. Here we have in this, amen, and this is looking like the greatest defeat in history. Jesus walked this earth for 3 years plus and claimed to be the Son of God. He said he was the Messiah. He healed the sick. He opened the eyes of the blind. Amen. He raised the dead. But there came a day that when they took him into Pilate's hall and he did not do anything about it, it looked like a great defeat. 12 men were despondent. They didn't know what to do. They were confused. They even denied that they knew who he was. That's powerful. And it looked like that Jesus, everything he said was all just words. It looked like that everything that he had promised was falling apart. It was a dark day on that Friday when they found him guilty. And they cried, crucify him. And they crucified him and put him in a tomb. All hope. Could you imagine standing at the foot of that cross and watching that Roman soldier stick a spear in his side and pull out blood and water and parts of his body? And he cried, Elalalabathama, my God, why have you forsaken me? It looked like a great defeat. for the Lord. Satan and I believe all of his imps was shouting, look what we have done. We have conquered who he said he was. Hallelujah. Can I get a witness in here? Amen. It looked like it was impossible. Could you imagine if you seen that, if you was there and seen what had happened and watched him give up the ghost and his head falls over and death has reigned over him like it has every man. See, death is your enemy. Death was your conqueror. Death had you, and nobody could get you away from the grips of death. The wisest man, the smartest man, the most intelligent man, the most military genius could not deliver you from the power of death. Can I get a witness in this house? Hallelujah. Amen. And he gave up the ghost, but the Bible said his spirit went into the heart of the earth where men was there. Can I get a witness one more time? Hallelujah. I'm preaching about us having life this morning. I'm preaching about us having something more than religion. How many glad you got more than religion this morning? How many glad you got something that you know is real by the grace of God, that nobody can't change you on what you know that you got this morning? Amen. Now, amen, that young lady that got saved this morning, the devil probably come to her and tell her, you didn't get saved. That's a good sign you did get saved. You know without a shadow of a doubt this morning. Amen. God's good. Amen. Amen. It looked like the greatest defeat in history. Jesus died. They put him in a tomb. The Pharisees and Sadducees came and said, you remember that deceiver, which was called Christ, said that he would rise that third day. They took him. Pilate got Roman soldiers. They went down to the tomb where they laid him in the tomb of Joseph Arimathea. And they put him in that tomb. They put a Roman seal upon that that could not be broken. They put guards at each side of that tomb that nobody could get hold of that body. But how many knows he didn't need all that? Hallelujah. And the guards that morning, when that shining light came and that earth shook, amen, there was an earthquake and that stone rolled away. Somebody ought to shout hallelujah. Amen. God said, I'm bigger than the Roman government. I'm bigger than a soldier. Amen. I'm God. Somebody ought to shout, he's still God today. And he came out, an old man death that had the victory over us. That grave that would say is your final place. That morning when he got up out of that grave, hallelujah, it's more than just a resurrection for him. It's a resurrection for you and I this morning. How many glad this morning for the resurrection of the Lord? And he took death and he defeated him and took the keys of death and of hell and walked out triumph over all the powers of hell. Hallelujah. We need some good preaching. Get on the power and the anointing of God again. We don't need no more sugar-coated preaching that'll just tell you what you want to hear. We need something that'll stir our souls and awaken us inside and make us realize, amen, Jesus is still coming this morning. Amen. You walk out in this world and you look at everything in the world. Amen. Everybody's got their mind on something, seems like, except the Lord. But he's still coming, friend. Ready or not, he's still coming. Can I get a witness in here? And what you do with him is going to make the difference. When that trumpet sounds and the dead in Christ is going to get up and us our alive is going to get up and we're going to be changed in the moment, in a twinkling. Friend, if you ain't got that, if you ain't based your faith on that, your faith is in vain. But this book is alive this morning. He's alive. And because he lives, I live this morning by the grace of God. What are you going to do with Jesus? Amen. Are you going to use him? Maybe for you're in trouble. You want him for trouble. That's all you want him for because you're in trouble. Now, I need him in my trouble. Don't get me wrong. But if I'm only using him in the time of trouble, I really don't know who he is. And God's mercy helps us out of trouble when God knows our alternative motive. Amen. Amen. I know people that will serve him because they want their marriage to work. But friend, if you don't serve God because you love him, after a while it's not going to work anyhow. Because it's been deceptive. Our children need to know something about God today. Amen. I see so many of our children, and they know so much about everything. There's nothing wrong with that. But they absolutely know nothing about the Lord. They know nothing about the power of God. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. We need to get them to realize, amen, that God is still God. Can I still get a witness in this house this morning? Because I want to tell you something. Amen. I hear people tell me this all the time. Preacher, when I get things just a little better fixed, then I'm going to serve God. You know, most time that never avails. Amen. Daniel, the 16th chapter of the book of Matthew this morning. I want to read you a couple stories. Amen. That the Lord dealt with me upon. Amen, that I'd had for a long time in the 16th chapter of the book of Matthew this morning. I know that God's a mighty good God. Amen. What are you going to do with Jesus? Do you just want him, you know, do you just want him enough to ease your conscience? Or do you want to serve him with everything you got? Amen. Do you want to serve him and love him that others will be drawn to him because of what you have for the Lord this morning? Somebody says, preacher, that's a whole lot. Amen. But friend, it's a life of peace like that. How many believes that this morning? In the 16th chapter of the book of Matthew, amen, the Bible says this. In verse 24, Jesus said unto them, unto his disciples, Matthew 16:24. Then Jesus said unto his disciples, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself. Your responsibility is to what? Take up your cross and follow. See, if you're not willing to deny yourself, you can't follow. This is in your Bible this morning. It ain't just what some preacher thinks about it. Amen. Next verse, please. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, and whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. Now you think about this. Listen to this scripture. For what it profit a man? For what is a man profited if he shall gain? Every one of us like to gain. Nothing wrong with gaining. He said, if you gain the whole world, but here's the thing. If you lose your soul, you think about that. If you lost your soul, or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? These are sobering things this morning. Listen to this story. The Roman Emperor Charlemagne knew that an interesting story surrounds the burial of this famous king. The story has it that he asked to be embalmed sitting upright in his throne. He asked that his crown be placed on his head and his scepter in his hand. He requested that the royal cape be draped around his shoulders and an open book be placed in his lap. This was the great Roman emperor. That was in A.D. 814. Nearly 200 years later, the emperor Otho determined to see if the burial request had been carried out. He alleged sent a team of men to open the tomb and to make a report. They found the body just as Charlemagne had requested. Only now, nearly two centuries later, the scene was gruesome. But opened on the skeleton thighs was the book that Charlemagne had requested. The Bible. One bony finger pointed to Matthew chapter 16 and verse 26. What good will it be for a man if he gains the whole world and he forfeits his soul? What good is it if you gain everything and lose your soul? That was one wise man. Can I get a witness in here? And you know, no matter what you was to sell your soul for, you would sell it cheap. No matter, because your soul is eternal. You are an immortal being this morning. And what you do with Jesus makes a difference where you're going to spend it. Can I get a witness in this house this morning? And you know what? I do not want to be where there's weeping and gashing of teeth, where there's sorrow and, amen, and pain and anguish. I want to be in a place of bliss and heavenliness. Amen, a place called heaven. Amen. Hallelujah. Give God a shout of praise on that this morning. Amen. I told you the story, amen, growing up in the church and how the old saints of God talked about dying. And they talked about dying as something great. Amen. They couldn't wait to go home and see Jesus. And they'd get up and shout about it and testify about it. And today, amen, we fear death more than any time in our lives. But I want you to know, live or die, it's Christ this morning. You got to have a made-up mind. You got to be determined by the grace of God. I'm going to serve God. If my family don't serve Him, I'm going to serve Him. If this don't work, I'm still going to serve Him. If things don't go my way, I'm going to serve Him. I got a made-up mind. What are you going to do with Jesus? I tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to make Him the Lord of my life. I'm going to make Him my Savior. I'm going to make Him my Lord and my King this morning. What are you going to do with Him? So many times I'm at the hospital. They call me. And they got a family member that's minutes away from death. They're on a ventilator. And they're going to have to make a decision to pull the plug. They look at me sometime and ask me that question, what would you do? Man, that's a hard question. What would you do? I don't give them that answer. That's not my choice. I can help them. I can give them directions. But that choice is theirs. And that's difficult on the family. But somebody has to make a choice. And it may be difficult for you to make a choice, but you got to make it. And really, you are making it regardless. That's good preaching to y'all. Am I going to serve Him all the way? I'm going to follow Him afar off? I'm going to just serve Him because I need Him? Am I going to serve Him because I fell in love with Him because He came by my way? When I met Sister Jean, my wife Jean, it was that time. I wasn't a brother and she wasn't a sister. When I met my wife, when she walked in the door, my dad pastored a little church out in the, what they call the Zion community. I don't know what else that's called out there. Between here in Columbia, on 55. And the way this was fixed, it was once a little store building, and my dad and him had turned it into a church. But the only door was in the front, and where they had it fixed, where they had the pulpit and all fixed, everybody was staring at the front door. I don't know what all that was about because I wasn't paying attention to that. But I remember the night Jean's mom had been coming for a while. Diane's mom had been bringing Callie. If Diane, yeah, I guess you was alive, but you just a little bitty girl. And I remember the night that she walked through the door. There was something different about her. See, God had a plan that I didn't understand. And she was pretty. Somebody shout amen. She was. And I thought, I'm going to talk to her. Now, you got to understand. And no, nothing bad. But, I mean, she wasn't to give 2 cents to speak to me. I don't think you could have paid her. Somebody shout amen. But my charm wouldn't let her go. That's sort of a laugh of doubt there. I got her. Threw candy bars and flowers and that's it. Somebody shout amen. You say, what's that got to do with all this? It has a lot to do with it because it was something different about her than anybody else. See, when you meet Jesus, there's something different about Him than anything else. And when you meet Him, your life will never be the same. When he touches your life, if you get cold and different, walk away. You can't walk away from what you've once had. Oh, glory, that's good news right there. Amen. Then we got to dating, and, amen, we were getting serious. And God gave her a dream. One night, she never told me this until after we were married. An angel came to the foot of her bed and told her that she would marry me, and she's still playing hard to get. That an angel stood at the foot of her bed and said that she would marry me and that I would be a preacher. I had no idea of ever being a preacher. Far as I was ever going to go was to play my guitar and help somebody else. That's as far as I was going to go. That's my plans. See, we've all got plans this morning, but God's got a plan. God has something for your life that you may not understand this morning. But God wants to fill a voidness in you that nobody else can fill. There's an emptiness in people. They're hungering. They're searching. They're looking for something that they can connect with. And let me tell you something. The only way you're going to fulfill that truly is Jesus Christ. Can I get a witness right there? Folks, if it ain't about him, we're wasting our time this morning. Amen. If Christ be not risen, let me tell you, my faith is in vain, my preaching is in vain, and everything I do is, amen, absolutely worthless if he's still in that tomb over there. But I got news for you. Buddha may still be in the tomb, which he is. Muhammad is still in the tomb, but Jesus is alive this morning, and he's making intercession for you and I. Hallelujah. He's on the throne of heaven this morning. That ought to be good news to every one of us, church. Amen. So what are we going to do with Jesus? Now, my wife had a choice after that. Amen. And we did get married by the grace of God. Amen. And I still didn't know that. And I never will forget. I was sitting in church, and I felt the presence of God. All y'all have these experiences. I just got to tell you mine this morning. The presence of God. And I felt a call beyond understanding. Didn't hardly understand what it even was. But from that day, my life changed. And I preached a message. And it didn't go over real good. I preached the rich man and Lazarus, and I told you the story. I studied for a week. I had everything I thought down. I thought I could preach it. I'd heard my dad preach it years and years, and I'd heard every preacher preach it, the rich man and Lazarus. And I thought, man, if anybody can preach on heaven and hell, rich man and Lazarus, amen, I could surely get through that one. And I got up there that night, and I was going to preach Mitchell Street Church of God in Columbia, Kentucky. I got up there, and amen, I was nervous. I'm still nervous, amen. And I read my text, done a pretty good job reading my text. I said, the rich man died and went to hell, and Lazarus was carried by angels into Abraham's bosom, and that was it. I run out of words. I run out of things. I didn't know my name. Somebody shout amen. I didn't even know who my name was. And the pastor finally looked and seen I was sinking for the third time and said, let's stand and pray for Brother Wayne. I said, well, hallelujah. Thank God we'll have a little church anyhow. Somebody shout amen. The biggest thing happened that night till at the time, amen, we had prayer meeting. Amen. But you know what? Amen. After that, I don't know, as a man sitting in the back, lost without God. I don't know if he felt sorry for me. I don't know what all it was. But God got a hold of his heart, and he came and gave his heart to God. Hallelujah. Give God a shout of praise. Amen. But then, amen, then after that, amen, I went home, and I realized, I came to the realization, I can't preach. Ain't no preacher in me. My dad, after that, he asked me for a revival, first revival. I'd preach three or four sermons. My dad asked me to preach a revival at Dumble Church of God over there. Amen. Thanks on Sunday night and go through a Sunday. That was 7 nights. Lord have mercy, my dad. Bless his little heart. And that whole church. And I preached that Noah was in the den of lions and Abraham was on the ark, and I don't know who I preached about. Somebody shout amen. God, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego drowned in a flood, I reckon. I don't know. Somebody shout amen. It was rough, folks. I tried, amen. You ought to try to preach on Elijah and Elisha. Amen. You get them mixed up if you ain't careful. And one sister stood up about the seventh, eighth night. She said, I really doubted that Brother Keith was called to preach. But she said, after these eight nights, I can see a glimpse of hope. Somebody said, I learned a lesson. I can't do it on my own. You can't serve God on your own. You can be religious, but you can't serve God without Christ. You've got to have Him as your Savior, as the captain of your ship. I sing that song sometimes, Captain, don't sail your boat without me, because I'd be lost in a world full of sorrow if He sailed His boat without me. Can I get a witness in here this morning? What are you going to do with Jesus today? I want to ask you a question. Every one of you is going to have to make that decision. You that's sitting here this morning, are you committed to God? Amen. Are you committed? Amen. I see people that's once committed and now they're not committed. Amen. Amen. You don't know when they're going to serve God, when they're not going to serve God, when they're coming to church, when they're not. Once you can depend on them, you can count on them with everything that you had. You could lay your life on line and say, I know they'll be there. And today, you don't even know where they're even at. Because they wasn't fully made up. Somebody enticed them. Something came along their way. Trouble happened. Amen. I got a cousin. Had a car wreck a few weeks ago. They did x-rays, make sure he was okay. Found a spot on his lung. They tried to do a biopsy and get the spot, to see what it was. They couldn't do it. They went into the lymph nodes somehow and done some things and took biopsy of the lymph nodes. He has third stage cancer. He's 30 some years old. I preached a funeral yesterday, and the preacher that helped me preach that funeral went to him immediately after he heard it. I didn't know it till the other day about the cancer of my cousin. He looked at him and said, son, would you like to pray? Would you like to surrender your life to God? Third stage cancer. Serious. And he looks and says, no, I don't think I want to serve God. The God of this world has blinded his mind. Because he don't realize to a point how long he's got to live. None of us to that point. But with his condition, he's not going to be in this world long. Unless God intervenes to him. Anybody hear what I'm telling you? And if you don't serve God, why did it profit you for the big house, the fine car? Nothing wrong with these things now. But if that's where your life is at, in things, they're all temporal. That's why the Bible says this, love not the world, neither the things that are in this world. What God is saying is, not that you can't live and you have to occupy and all this, but do not put your trust in temporal things because they'll fade away. Can I get a witness in here? Amen. My daddy, get my daddy come down here. Come here, daddy. Come here. Can I preach y'all for just another minute? What are you going to do with Jesus this morning? This is how I feel by the grace of God. Amen. My daddy's 84 years old. Is that right, Mama? 83. He'll be 84 in August. August the 5th, he'll be 84 years old. Now, I love my daddy. My daddy's still a pretty good man. But I remember, this is the memory I've got. I don't see an 84-year-old man. Or 83. Man. Yes, you was. But you know what? His life has went by so fast, just like mine has. And if you don't do something with it, it's going to come and go. And you've got to look back, and there ain't nothing back there. But I remember this man driving of a night and going to church, him and Mama. Taking us kids, that's for their seatbelt laws. We sleep over the back, between the seat and the windshield. Maybe I had one in the seat, one on the back of the windshield. Anybody remember them days? Amen. One the floorboard. Mama fixed dinner. Amen. We had J-Boy in the back seat. Somebody shout amen. We had a Big Mac in the back seat without a Big Mac. Somebody shout amen. But you know what? His life. Now, I remember when this man was standing up, take a 100-pound sack of feed and could throw it. Is that right up on the back of a truck? See, his life is temporal. He can't do that today. I can't do it today. You listen to me? And no matter what you put your trust in, if he had put his trust in his natural abilities, he wouldn't be doing anything today. But he put his trust in Jesus a long, long time ago. And he gave me something. He left me, he's leaving me a heritage. He's leaving me something that the world can't take away. Can I get a witness? He's never been perfect, never claimed to be. But I'll tell you one thing. I know he loves the Lord. Amen. You can go over there, amen, at 12 o'clock of a day or sometime 4 o'clock. He's sitting at that table, got that Bible open. He's reading that Bible. Said, I'm learning something about the Lord. Hallelujah. Somebody ought to give God a shout of praise in here this morning. Your life is... See, your life is a vapor. It's gone. Your strength will be gone. Your beauty. Somebody shout amen. You can put all the cover-up girl on it you want to. But it's still there. Now, if it worked, honey, I'd have cover-up girl all over it. Somebody shout amen. I ain't ashamed to tell you. But it won't cure you. Only thing that can be lasting is Jesus Christ and Him, your Savior, this morning. Listen to me as I get ready to close. What are you going to do with Jesus? If you had a decision today, you had to pull the plug, how would that weigh on you? Amen. You've got a greater decision than that. What am I going to do with Jesus? Will I serve Him wholeheartedly? Or will I serve Him the way I want to? Will I serve Him, just give Him enough to ease my conscience? Friend, I want to ask you a question. Amen. Daniel, if you got the picture of those hands this morning, amen, I want to tell you something. Amen. It looked like an ultimate defeat. But amen, there's two winning hands this morning. They was nail pierced. Can I get a witness in here? But they're winning hands this morning. Those sweet hands of the Lord Jesus that was nailed to a bloody, rugged cross, paid your sin debt and mine this morning by the grace of God. What are you going to do with Jesus? What are you really going to do with Him? That decision is yours and yours alone. What I do with Him this morning, amen, is my decision alone this morning. Amen. What are you going to do with Jesus? Think about that this morning. Amen. If you're lost in this building, you need Jesus. If you're cold and indifferent, you need the Lord this morning. And we live in a very lukewarm age today. Amen. Amen. A dabble do, but that ain't going to help you, friend. It's going to take Jesus. How many believes that? Amen. Those two winning hands, those nail-pierced hands. Amen. Do you love Him this morning? Do you love Him this morning? Amen. I ask you again, what are you going to do with a man called Jesus? Let me read you this right here as they finish getting that up. He is born in a stable in the village of Bethlehem. He was reared as a carpenter of Nazareth. He was a citizen of a nation that was conquered and subdued by the Roman Empire. A man whose mortal footsteps never went beyond 150 miles, who never received a school degree, never spoke in great pulpits, he never owned a home, traveled on foot, yet he was actually the creator of heaven and earth. Can I get a witness? He's the author of my salvation this morning. A man that did not go all over the whole world, but yet made an impact on every person's life because of what he did at Calvary. Let me tell you this. Almost 700 years before he was crucified, listen to this. Over 300 prophecies he fulfilled. It's impossible for a man to fulfill them if he hadn't been God. Isaiah wrote 700 years before Jesus was crucified. Of Isaiah chapter 53, he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we were healed. 700 years before the nation, listen, before crucifixion ever was invented, Isaiah saw him crucified. Before there was even a crucifixion ever mentioned, before that man was ever done that way, amen, Isaiah saw it. I ask you this morning, what will you do with Jesus? They come to the music. What are you going to do with Jesus? I believe everyone needs to make a commitment this morning to say, God, it's all the way. With those two winning hands this morning, by the grace of an almighty God. Somebody shout amen. Amen. Lock me up in prison. Amen. I want you to bow your heads this morning for just a moment. And I want you to ask God, God, am I going to go all the way with you this morning? God, am I serving you with everything that I am this morning by your grace and mercy? Lord, am I cold and indifferent and nothing doesn't move me and I feel half-hearted this morning, and God, I'm not really committed. God, I want a commitment this morning by the grace of God. Think about it. Are you willing to follow him all the way? Are you willing to follow him wherever he leads this morning? I am what I am by the grace of God. Think about it this morning. Your family's in trouble. Your life is in a mess. If you don't know where to turn, Jesus is your answer this morning. Amen. The world don't have your answers. The midnight hours when you're shedding tears on your pillow and you don't know where to turn and you feel lonely and nobody's there, Jesus is there this morning. Would you just reach out to him this morning? Come on, just reach out to him this morning. Let him touch your heart and your life. Nobody, Jesus paid a price that you don't have to go to hell. He don't want you to go to hell. Hell wasn't a place prepared for you. It's prepared for the devil and his angels. But you've got a choice this morning. What are you going to do with Jesus? There's two winning hands that reaching out to you this morning. There's two nail-pierced hands reaching out and saying, if you'll take them, you can have life and have it more abundantly this morning. You can lock me up in a prison and throw away the key. Anybody want to pray? Deprive me of the food. Jackie, that's in Lexington Hospital in very critical condition. Come on, would you just reach out and love him this morning? This altar's still open. Amen. Hallelujah. Would you stand to your feet all this building and ask God, amen, to touch every heart in here this morning? Hallelujah. Would you still like to come and pray? Somebody still needs to pray in this building this morning. That don't know the Lord. Let's ask God to visit these children and these young people, and that God will touch the hearts of everybody that's here by the power of God. Reach your hands this way right now. Father, you see, ask you to bless their singing, their drama, the skits. God, everything is said and done for the glory of God. Father, the power of God would touch in this place tonight. Father, the power of God would touch everyone that will be gathered here tonight. Father, we thank you for it. God, we honor you for it today. Bless these children, God, and they'll have a boldness in them. God, to exemplify you, there's been a change in their lives. Father, bless every endeavor that they do tonight. In the name of Jesus, let's give God a praise, would you? He said I could still go free. Come on, give God a praise.
Oh, tell me what kind of a man would reach down his head and do this for me. Yeah.
power of God. In the name of Jesus, I believe that. Victory in Jesus. How many believes that? Amen. As we celebrate this day, folks, it's about more than an Easter bunny and Easter eggs and all. It's about a resurrected Savior with healing in his wings. How many believes that this morning? Amen. Amen. Let me make this announcement before we dismiss this morning. And amen. I want to say it's good to have all of our visitors this morning. It's good to have also for the first time Brother Adam and Jacqueline Coffey this morning for their first time. God bless you for being with us this morning. Amen. God bless you. Amen. I think everybody else has been here. Amen. But man, we thank God for you for your first time and appreciate the goodness of God. Tonight is our youth night, and they're going to have the hand-signed drama, the skits. I don't know what Brother Seth is going to be teaching us tonight, and I can't wait to see that. Amen. And it's going to be awesome. Amen. I don't want him to feel no pressure, but I'm sure expecting a whole lot. Amen. But God is good. How many knows that God is a good God? Amen. Love Brother Seth. Amen. How many's been joined in the house of the Lord this morning? Okay, yes, yes. That'll be food for the children after. And what's your time? I'm all in. But God's good. But tell your neighbor, what are you going to do with Jesus? Amen. Oh, I just want to say, it's good to have Sister Carol's aunt for her first time. I forgot that. Amen. It's good to have you this morning, too. Amen.